But now, here on Thames, tonight's special report from This Week.
In Kabul today, the West has so far been proved wrong. Instead of collapse, the city is holding on. Afghan Air Force helicopters lift off from an army base near Kabul. They fly at treetop height to avoid sophisticated anti-aircraft missiles, but they can now be hit by small arms fire. Helicopter pilots in Afghanistan need to be alert. This, according to Western predictions, was one journey that journalists should not have been able to make. It was the Kabul government's way of demonstrating which side controlled Afghanistan's most strategic link. The helicopters took us north of Kabul towards the mountains of the Hindu Kush. We followed the Salang Highway, originally built by the Russians and now the Kabul government's supply lifeline to the Soviet Union. If the road can be kept open, the guerrillas will fail in their objective of starving Kabul into submission. Once in the mountains, we were put on board armoured personnel carriers to see a 20-kilometre stretch of the Salang Highway. It well deserves the nickname Ambush Alley. In their 9-year embroilment in Afghanistan, the Russians fought to keep the Salang open, and the Mujahideen guerrillas fought to close it. The debris of war is everywhere. This stretch of road was blocked by a guerrilla force until a month ago. In the past, entire supply convoys have been halted, shot up, and burnt out. Petrol tankers are a particularly favoured target. Without fuel, the government army stops. And not a villager moves. As the Russians prepared to pull out, they destroyed every community on the highway. The Russians created a desert in Afghanistan and failed even to establish peace. On the day we went to the Salang, this stretch of road was undoubtedly open. A guerrilla attack could just as certainly close it again, but in the meantime, Kabul's army is winning its spurs. A few months ago, these soldiers were written off. There's now something to celebrate. One of the West's errors was the failure to see how the Soviet Union had revived the Afghan army. When the Russians took over the war, this army became a demoralized, defection-ridden rump. Fighting on without the Russians seems to have raised their spirits. I asked their commanding officer if he was confident they would keep the rebels off the road.
We are sure because we have taken one of their strongest posts in this area.
So what has happened to the Mujahideen units that used to operate in this area?
At the moment, they have fled behind the Salang Highway about 7 kilometers from here.
But a new pattern may be starting to emerge to the conflict in Afghanistan. It takes account not just of the military balance, but of Afghanistan's intricate tribal politics as well. One of the ways in which the government has been securing this vital highway has been an extraordinary series of deals with local guerrilla commanders. The commanders stopped their fighting in exchange, first, for being allowed to run their own affairs, and secondly, and here's the sweetener, for a share of all the goods, food and petrol that comes down from the Soviet Union by convoy on this highway. The eastern city of Jalalabad has been the target of the largest guerrilla offensive in a decade of war. Jalalabad is closest to the Mujahideen source of weapons in Pakistan. A military takeover is now considered only one of the possibilities.
It's also possible that at some point in the future, some months I think rather than weeks, a significant section of the guerrillas, whether field commanders or political parties, will form a compromise government with Kabul and thereby broaden the base of the regime. But I have to say, I think it's now looking less and less probable that the Kabul regime will in fact fall. It's shown that it can survive the first few weeks, and as long as it keeps supplies from the Soviet Union coming, as long as it keeps its dominance of the air, then it will remain in a very credible position.
On Revolution Day itself, Soviet transport planes firing flares to deflect missiles continued to fly ammunition into Kabul. But this was also a day for remembering the dead. Not the tens of thousands of civilians from both sides, but the soldiers who have died in defence of the Russian-backed regime. The military dead are buried in the Martyrs' Cemetery, and on Revolution Day, VIPs from the East Bloc came to commemorate them. They also came to mark the regime's survival during 12 critical weeks without the support of 115,000 Soviet troops. The Russians entered Afghanistan in 1979 because they thought the communist regime would collapse. The collapse was averted, and survival is still underpinned by Soviet arms. Kabul's refusal to fall means that the war in Afghanistan has now entered a grim new phase. With Russian soldiers back behind their own frontiers, the conflict here has reverted to the civil war that preceded the Soviet intervention of a decade ago. The difference and the tragedy for Afghanistan is that the two superpowers are arming their friends in the field as never before. Both the Soviet Union and the United States apparently prepared to fight, as one cynical expression puts it, to the last Afghan.
A rocket on Revolution Day. The victims this time were two little girls. Their family saw them die. The rocket landed in the family compound, probably Chinese manufacture, paid for by American intelligence. Anahita was 12. Her sister Asiba was 8. In all, 23 people were killed in Kabul by Revolution Day rockets. It was the Mujahideen's way of signaling their disapproval of the celebration. Another Revolution Day rocket lands in a residential area. Another 4-year-old called Ataullah is in a coma. 4 members of his family have already died today. And Ataullah will also die on Revolution Day. A 12-year-old girl called Leila is very lucky. According to the doctor, her chest injury is superficial and she'll be home in a few days. In the operating theatre, surgeons are looking for another piece of the same missile. It's lodged in the bladder of Leilab's 9-year-old brother, Mustafa. Mustafa's mother describes what happened.
I was walking with my children when one of them screamed. I rushed to him and I saw blood coming down his leg from his pants. He told me he was hit. My face was turned the other way when I also got hurt by shrapnel. I told my children to run away.
Dr. Abdul Salam Jalali is head of the Indira Gandhi Institute of Child Health. He's been caring for the victims of the Afghan conflict for years. This 10-year-old lost a leg through a Revolution Day rocket. For Dr. Jalali, there is now less and less sense to all the killing and maiming.
I would like to see the children not coming because of war injuries to our hospital. Since the withdrawal of Soviet troops, the peace should come to our country, because it is a war between the two brothers. They should sit with each other and they should solve the problem. And I invite the international community to help us, because this is a very necessary war. It is just between two brothers, and they are killing each other.
Young brothers and sisters of the revolution, helping to celebrate 11 years of a system that has brought little but bloodshed to Afghanistan. President Najibullah now tries to give it a new direction. The regime's military guard will be kept up, but the political accent is upon the need for settlement. Najibullah says he will share power, even give up power, as part of a settlement. But the enemies of the revolution still want to see its destruction. And for the time being, the pressures on Kabul, its regime and its people will be sustained. Despite the air of normality, Kabul lives on a knife edge. The unreliability of supplies threatens to tip poverty into starvation. These bakeries are making bread from government flour, trying to feed a city population that has maybe doubled because of the war. But the government can only send to the bakeries what reaches the city in aid from the Soviet Union. The bread here costs a subsidized 8p a loaf, and is all that most people can afford.
The market price here, for example, has trebled since September. It has doubled since January. And it's beyond the reach of people. Ordinary Kabulis, and in particular the vulnerable groups that we're trying to reach ourselves.
The United Nations has been living a hand-to-mouth existence of its own in Kabul. In the last few months, the UN has made distributions to some 15,000 families, but the flour and sugar are running out. Staff have to keep back the women who will not get rations. Western governments, like the British, will not give food to the UN for fear of bolstering the regime. After this distribution, there was only one day's supply left.
I have to recall that this was one of the poorest countries in the world 10 years ago, before this war started. And it has now had 10 years of devastating war. It is now that much poorer, and it's going to take a lot of resolve and effort by the Afghans themselves, an enormous amount of assistance from the international community, in order to get them back to the very unsatisfactory state of affairs they were in 10 years ago.
In Kabul, there is political fallout from all the years of shortages and disruption brought on by the war. We found a terrible war weariness, made worse because the Soviet withdrawal seems to have brought peace no nearer. We'd expected a dutiful loyalty towards the regime. Instead, we encountered indifference and some hostility, even a wish to accommodate the Islamic conservatism of the Mujahideen. On the campus at Kabul University, we thought that young women students would be among the government's supporters. The revolution was staged in the name of social progress, after all, and the regime can point to advances in the cause of women. But again, we were surprised. Young women put the need to end the war above everything else. The question was the conservatism of the Mujahideen and the issue of the veil.
Mujahideen haven't come yet. If they come and we know the principle, we could decide. And now we don't know about their principles. If they come and the peace will also come, we will accept to wear veil and we will stay at home if there's peace.
You would accept to wear a veil?
Yes. When there's war and the women are illiterate and they have knowledge, when there's war, what's the use of this knowledge?
Does everyone here accept to wear a veil if the Mujahideen come?
Yes, if there is peace, we will.
You would accept to wear a veil?
Yes, of course.
And would you accept to wear the veil?
Yes.
Do you think the Mujahideen, if they come, do you think they will push the women back into the homes?
I think so, yeah.
It doesn't matter if I am ruled by Mujahideen or this government. I want peace. The government doesn't matter for me.
The Mujahideen say they are fighting for Islam, a holy war against godless communism. But again, there are no rigid battle lines. Mosques in Kabul are often hit in rocket attacks. An elderly man died in this one. Does the mosque's chief priest see the Mujahideen as the custodians of Islam?
They are not fighting for Islam. They are fighting for their private gain. They seek power that is beyond them. So instead, they are killing innocent people.
Do you support this present government?
We support what is right. We hold the view that England, America, France, Germany and Saudi Arabia should, for the sake and for fear of God and for Islam, use the aid they give not to kill and destroy us, but rather use it in building our country and our lives. But why are they not doing so? Because they want to use our people to fight among themselves and to kill one another while they remain as spectators. But they are not mere spectators. They have responsibility for what goes on here.
The saddest and commonest refrain in Afghanistan, that the continuing war is less a conflict among the Afghans than a war of outsiders. On the Kabul side, the pride of one superpower is fully engaged. A defeat for the regime would be a serious blow for Soviet standing among its allies. So Kabul will be supplied with what it needs. This aircraft began a new food airlift into the capital. But for every food shipment, there are many more arms shipments. Each flight protected by anti-missile flares. The government receives the most sophisticated weaponry it can handle to combat the Mujahideen.
The Russians are supplying arms to the Kabul regime, and they've made very clear that they intend to keep their commitments for military aid and economic aid to the Kabul government. But the Russians are also looking to broaden the Kabul regime, and they are appealing to the West and Pakistan, without any success, to set up some kind of coalition government. But what they're really saying is, if you don't set up a coalition government now, and Najib survives another year, then the chances of there being a coalition will be much less, because Najib will have much less of an incentive to compromise.
American Stinger anti-aircraft missiles being loaded onto a Mujahideen pack horse. Stinger supplies may now have been halted because of fears that the guerrillas were passing the weapons on to Iranian groups. But the provision of other weapons continues uninterrupted. The Afghan connection is the CIA's largest ever operation. So the pride of the other superpower, the United States, is also fully engaged in the outcome of the Afghan conflict.
The Americans have not altered their policy. They are still going for a military solution in Afghanistan. They're saying it's going to take longer, it might take 2 or 3 years, but they're going to put in more weapons into Afghanistan. They are still encouraging the Pakistanis to go into Afghanistan and support the guerrillas. And therefore the Americans have, as it were, retreated from their most optimistic strategy, but have come up with a new one. They're talking about stamina, a long haul, a war of attrition, but they're saying that in the end, Jalalabad will fall, Kabul will fall. So they are very much still in there, and they're not looking for the kind of compromise that the Russians are looking for.
On Kabul's perimeter, units of the Afghan army are geared up for defense. In 3 months, there has been no major guerrilla attack, not even one to divert attention from Jalalabad. Nor has there been an internal insurrection. So what happens next? Does Robert Fox see the prospect of a significant or successful assault on Kabul this summer?
I think they have to have a go. They have to have a go simply for propaganda purposes and to signal to their sponsors and the outside world that we are serious, that we do intend to defeat the Najibullah regime and we do intend to set up our National Liberation Government.
And could they succeed?
I don't think they will. I don't think they will because of the things that we see around ourselves here and because they have, again, got to convert themselves from a rural guerrilla army into an army which is capable of taking and holding a city. They've taken cities, one or two in the past, but they've shown no capability of holding ground for any length of time.
Sweeping the streets of Kabul, another semblance of normality. But everything here is expectation and uncertainty, a war without an end in view. The man in charge, the mayor of Kabul, is a retired general.
The question, General, is whether you can, in your view, hold Kabul without Soviet troops.
Yes, we held it already. We hold it, I mean.
And through the summer?
Through the summer, too.
And
the
next winter?
No question, I hope so.
You don't see any chance now?
Maybe there will be some difficulties, but I don't see any chance for them to come here to keep Kabul. If they took Kabul, I'll be in the mountain and I'll fight against them.
The prospect of an outright guerrilla victory in Afghanistan is now receding. Sooner or later, that may prompt a reassessment by the Mujahideen and their Western backers. In the meantime, the people of Afghanistan will keep paying the price. 9-year-old Mustafa emerges from the operating theatre, a piece of shrapnel successfully removed from his bladder. We were told he will make a good recovery. His mother, Shafika, sums up the impact of the war on her own and other families.
The effects of the war have been nothing but destruction and killings. People suffer hunger and their lives are destroyed. We are poor and have to provide food for our children and buy them clothes. We have to go through great hardship. But then we get injured and hit by bullets and are brought to hospital to rot. These are the effects of war.
For the civilian people of Afghanistan, the prayer is for peace to be granted soon.